Hello everyone, today we're going to take a magical field trip to puddles that only appear in the spring, and we're going to investigate the life that's found within them. Small reminder folks, if you're going to be out collecting things for jars, make sure that you're legally able to do so. After the rare good rain in Southern California, sometimes small puddles can form. We know these as vernal pools. These pools are rare and often do not last long, but they support an incredible diversity of life. Let's take a closer look. What you're witnessing just beneath the surface here are mostly ostracods, but also the odd copepod darting by. Both of these tiny crustaceans are real survivors and can be found in almost any aquatic environment on Earth. These particular ones just hatched out less than a week ago when the rains came. The eggs that these two have hatched out from can last months to years, waiting for the rains to come once more so that they can hatch anew. They are now feeding on detritus and algae found in this vernal pool. Further down the trail, we can see that spring has officially arrived as even the cacti are in bloom. Here on the side of the trail, I spotted another vernal pool. This one too is filled with ostracods and copepods. Most of these pools can only exist in places where there is an impermeable layer of sediment underneath, such as a compacted soil or clay or even rock. This prevents the water from draining too quickly, allowing the pools to persist just long enough for aquatic life to complete their cycles. This one here is a sight to behold. It was the biggest one I found all day. In addition to being the largest one I found all day, there is a special inhabitant here. And here is our very special star of our show. These only exist when these puddles are formed and are gone when they dry. They are known as fairy shrimp. These delicate, translucent creatures only exist in seasonal pools like these. They hatch from eggs that are buried in the dry soil and grow quite rapidly before reproducing and then disappearing with the pool itself. As soon as the pools fill with water, these fairy shrimp will hatch and very quickly begin feeding and growing. Their ultimate goal to get to reproduction as fast as possible to ensure the survival of their future generations. This process can take between 7 to 14 days for these particular fairy shrimp. While they may seem misguided and aloof, these graceful swimmers are taking in as much algae, bacteria, protozoans, rotifers, and bits of waste as they possibly can to grow fast. As tempting as it may have been to collect some of these for a jar to take home and observe, I resisted because, well, in my research before taking the trip out here, I found that there is a species of fairy shrimp in this area that is covered by the Endangered Species Act, and it would be ill-advised to be messing with that species. We come to the last pool that I visited that day. While there were no fairy shrimp in this one, each pool does have its own unique features. For this one in particular, it was the fact that it had much more detritus and plant matter than the rest. But there was one more feature that was rather unique, and it was these copepods here. You'll see that the males had a particular red color, and the females were darker with colored eggs. While I don't know the exact cause, I would guess that it had something to do with their diet in this particular pool. Before leaving for the day, this sign caught my eye. Unfortunately, the reservoir that I was at was undergoing an algal bloom. And it's not actually algae, it's actually cyanobacteria that are causing this problem. These cyanobacteria can produce toxins that will cause a variety of ill effects for humans. And funny enough, it's usually humans that are causing these blooms to happen in the first place. This is usually due to excess nutrients from things like fertilizers used in agricultural or suburban landscapes. If excessive enough, these algal blooms can block out the light for all the plants below, and eventually can end up decaying and, well, leading to a dead zone where there is very little oxygen for fish or anything else to live. And please don't get regular algae confused with these cyanobacteria. Most algae are harmless and are an important part at the base of many food webs in aquatic environments. I hope that through these videos that you realize that nature is out there calling you to come visit. Your endeavor to maintain a natural aquarium could be greatly aided by actually going out and monitoring nature, observing how all the plants and animals are in one great cycle supporting each other, observing the behavior of every organism in your tank, making sure that they're all happy and healthy and performing natural behaviors. And well, just like outside, every tank that you set up, no matter if you use the same components, will end up a little bit different. And you should embrace this diversity. Don't try to change it. And so ends our first day exploring vernal pools. I decided to return 3 days later to see how they had changed. The first pool that we visited was now completely dried up, with not a trace of it having existed. It seems our second pool had met the same fate. It too completely dried without much of a trace. It seemed that the pools were all coming to an end. Our fairy shrimp pool was nearing its last stages too. Unfortunately, some people who didn't know better were riding their bikes through the middle of it, causing there to be lots of sediment in the water. Despite being trampled upon, life still persisted. There were many ostracods that could be seen, each one of them helping to break down detritus and cycle nutrients back to the soils. They would also go on to feed small birds and insects who may come by the pool later when it dries. They indicated that the health of this pool was still top-notch, as they serve as biological indicators of pH, temperature, and even pollution. And even our friends the fairy shrimp were still persisting despite the cloudier conditions, performing their lovely underwater ballet. Both species seemed completely unaware or perhaps did not care about their impending doom. Unlike permanent wetlands, vernal pools often have low nutrient availability, which prevents invasive plant species from taking over. When the rain falls and these pools are developing, microbial mats will form, thin layers of bacteria, algae, and organic material that will serve as food for the ostracods, copepods, and fairy shrimp. When these pools eventually do dry, these mats decompose, leaving behind nutrient-rich detritus that fuels the next cycle when the pools refill again. Visible underneath this fairy shrimp are the cysts, which are the eggs that can undergo long periods of dryness before hatching. These cysts can survive periods of extreme dryness, high temperatures, and being buried for many years, sometimes even decades, before the conditions are right for them to hatch. Let us now say goodbye to the fairy shrimp, from the mud they came, and to the mud they shall return. Soon, their pool too will be like the one adjacent, and be dry. The eggs of all these once living aquatic organisms will fall into the cracks of the soil as they form, and wait again for the rains to return. If there is one thing that holds true in this climate, it is that the tyranny of the sun holds no end. Now let's take a look at what we've learned from these seasonal pools and apply it to something more familiar, a natural aquarium. While vernal pools and aquariums may seem like completely different worlds, they actually function in surprisingly similar ways. In both vernal pools and aquariums, tiny creatures like ostracods and copepods play a critical role in breaking down waste and recycling nutrients. In an aquarium, ostracods, copepods, and other microcrustaceans will feed on uneaten food, plant debris, and algae, helping to maintain water quality. This is why many aquarists intentionally seed their tanks with copepods, daphnia, and ostracods, because these tiny animals are acting as natural janitors. Just as vernal pool soils store nutrients, eggs, and microbial life, the substrate in a natural aquarium does the same thing. In a planted tank, a rich layered substrate provides a habitat for beneficial bacteria, microorganisms, and invertebrates. Over time, a mature aquarium substrate develops a living ecosystem, just like the dormant soils of a vernal pool. Many aquarists culture live foods like Daphnia and copepods in separate tanks, mimicking the way vernal pools naturally produce waves of food when conditions are right. The harmful algal bloom that we saw in the reservoir is an extreme version of what can happen in a poorly maintained aquarium. If you have too many nutrients and stagnant water, you too could have an algae explosion. In contrast, controlled algal growth, like the biofilm that the ostracods and the snails graze on, is actually beneficial, whether in a vernal pool or an aquarium. Both vernal pools and aquariums remind us that good things take time. A new tank goes through cycles, just like a vernal pool evolving from freshly filled water to a thriving microcosm. Both ecosystems rely on microbial activity, detritivores, and natural cycles to stabilize and reach balance. Just as the vernal pools may look lifeless now, we know that it's anything but. In your aquarium, well, when things seem quiet, the ecosystem is always at work behind the scenes, cycling nutrients, growing biofilms, and preparing for the next wave of life. Understanding how temporary wetlands work can teach us a lot about how to create and maintain thriving, self-sustaining aquariums. So next time you see a dried up puddle, remember, it just might be a miniature ecosystem waiting for the right moment to come back to life. If you enjoyed this deep dive into vernal pool ecology and how it connects to natural aquariums, hit that like button and subscribe for more aquatic explorations. Let me know in the comments, would you try adding ostracods or copepods to your tank?